afternoon, and thank you all so much for joining us for today's program. My name is Melissa Loriano, and I serve as the Programs Manager for the DC Preservation League. For those of you who may be new to DCPL, we are a citywide nonprofit organization dedicated to preserving, protecting, and enhancing the historic built environment of Washington, DC through advocacy and education. So I'd like to first acknowledge some of DCPL's top sponsors, whose annual financial support helps underwrite public programs like this one today. They are Denton's, Douglas Development, Antunovich Associates, Atlantic Refinishing and Restoration, Buyer Blinder Bell, Building Innovation Hub, EHT Traceries, and KCE Structural Engineers. So many thanks to you all for your dedication to historic preservation in the district. I also want to share some notes about how our program is going to work today. So please use the Q&A box found at the bottom of your screen to ask any questions of our speaker. I will collect your questions and verbally ask them of our presenter after her presentation. And for those of you joining us on Facebook Live, DCPL's Executive Director, Rebecca Miller, will be monitoring any questions that you all might have and will pass those along to me as well. So with that, I'm so pleased to introduce you all to today's guest. Shellée M. Haynesworth is an award-winning multimedia maker, storyteller, and culture keeper. Throughout her more than 20-plus year career and through her multimedia firm, Indigo Creative Works, she has produced documentaries, multicultural, and digital media projects for clients such as the U.S. Agency for International Development, U.S. Department of Education, Smithsonian Institution, Gates Foundation, PBS, NBC, Black Entertainment Television, TV One, HBO, and King World Entertainment, among others. As a storyteller, her focus has been to examine the African diaspora and shed light on the untold human stories and hidden contributions of African American and Latino changemakers in history, social justice, arts, culture, and humanities. Some of her documentary and broadcast credits include Latino Voices, Art and Culture, The History Makers, An Evening with Quincy Jones, Latino Music Greats, and Women, Land Rights, A Ripple Effect, amongst others. Shellée is also joined by another special guest, Ms. Joyce Ross, who will be sharing stories of her own time hanging out at some of these historic theaters. So thank you very much to you both for taking the time to be here today. And with that, I will pass things along to Shellée.
Thank you, and good afternoon, everyone. And thank you for joining us, Ms. Ross and I. We're both native Washingtonians, and we're delighted to be here. And I also would like to thank DC Preservation League, Melissa and Rebecca, for the invitation. And thank you to the sponsors for making this programming available to our community. And as Melissa shared, I'm the executive producer and creator of the Black Broadway on You project. And I launched the project in 2014. And basically the thrust of the project, it's a multiple platform, but it's also multimedia. And we just do a deep historical dive into different subjects. And ultimately the goal and the mission of the project is to tell the story through the lens of our community elders and stakeholders so that they can share their fond memories and firsthand memories about what took place along the U Street corridor. And of course, today we're gonna talk about some of the Black theaters and the cultural impact and legacy of some of those theaters that existed along the U Street corridor during the heydays of U Street when it was known as Black Broadway. So to set the tone, I always feel, and I'm sure we've heard that old adage about how pictures tell the story. So I just have just a short presentation so that you can get a sense of the integration of the theaters and how it impacted the African-American community when it was known as specifically along the U Street corridor when it was known as Black Broadway. So let's take a quick look at some of those moments from some of these theaters, and we'll be right back. This is just a quick presentation. Thank you. So I hope you all enjoyed that quick trip back down memory lane and some of the historical theaters, Lincoln Theater, Howard Theater, Booker T, Dunbar. And those are some of the theaters we're going to talk about with Ms. Ross, as well as we'll do a deeper historical dive into just learning and discovering a little bit more about these theaters if you aren't aware of that history. So I'd like to invite Mrs. Joyce Ross, who is one of my favorite community elders, who I've had the great pleasure of knowing for a while. I won't go into the number of years. However, I've enjoyed through the years just hearing her share her fond memories about working, living, socializing, and fellowshipping along the U Street corridor when it was known as Black Broadway. So Ms. Ross, if you could just share with us some of your fondest memories and hanging out at some of those places. Did those images take you back to that magic moment in time?
Yes, good afternoon, everyone. Yeah, the images definitely took me back. And I'd like to start just a little bit earlier before I was able to say get to the clubs. Mm-hmm. Just as a youngster, I'd say around 11 or 12, just to be able to go up U Street. We didn't know anything about it. I didn't know anything about it being Black Broadway, but just going up U Street, there was a special aura about being up there. When you got there was a feeling of pride. And if you looked at those pictures, you saw how everybody was all dressed up. Okay, we did not go up there unless you were presentable. You had to represent, and I mean, that's from a little child up. And before I was able to go to those fabulous clubs, just going to the theaters, you would look at your family members and the neighbors when they're getting ready to go out on the town. And you would see the excitement and just the joy of getting yourself ready to go up to have some fun, especially on the weekends, because we have to, the time that I'm talking about, the 40s into the 50s, at the time when, of course, we were totally separate during the time of segregation. You could not go to the things that were downtown, but we had everything up here. And I think even as a child, there was something instilled in you, this is something special that we have. And we want to treat it that way. And this is the way we want to feel and act when we go there. But I was so glad when I was able not only to go to the theaters, but all of the nightclubs that we had up there. And as a child, the restaurants. So for me, it went beyond the theaters. You know, I looked at the pictures of when you look at Howard Theater and how dressed up, you'd have to stand in line to buy a ticket to go in. Then you go around Wilkes-Barre Street and you got to stand in line again to get in. But you did it. It was expectation. We know you're going to have a good show. All of the big name stars, when I saw the name of Lucky Millinder, people don't even know anything about that name. But see, that triggered because I remember seeing all of the big stars, all of the vaudeville stars. I'm sure you all never heard of anybody called Butterbean and Susie, but as a child, I can remember seeing those kind of acts. Duke Ellington, who was also my alma, he went to my alma mater, Billy Eckstein, Sarah Vaughan. I mean, those were all of the big stars of my day. And growing up, just to be able to go there, go to Lincoln Theater, where actually you could see, first one, yeah, movies. You didn't have to wait until it comes around. But again, it was just the pride of having these things, but also the supporting things that were in the neighborhood. And I saw when I looked at Lincoln Colonnade, to this day, I cannot figure out how we got into there, went into that tunnel, and all of a sudden you were in the ballroom. I have not figured out yet where the actual edifice was for that fabulous ballroom. But those are, so as I said, as a child, you watch your elders and all preparing to get involved in that. But as a young adult, I was able to experience it.
Excellent. Now, what I often heard many elders and you as well share that during the day, you could even go to the Howard Theater and, 11 o'clock noon or, yes, 3 o'clock and catch some of these great jazz musicians or doo-wop artists or big bands. What was your fondest or favorite show that you saw? And you mentioned Lucky Milliner. Was there any other shows that stand out?
When the first time I saw Duke Ellington, that was always, growing up, we didn't have, of course, at my age, you didn't have television. So there was a lot of music at home. And so I can remember hearing some of his music. And I just had a fondness for him. He was the main one, but it was so many. But when I was able to see him and Billy Eckstein,
And he
was so gorgeous. So.
And you mentioned that. So Billy Eckstein, Duke Ellington, and yourself, you all attended Armstrong, right?
Yes.
Armstrong High School. Awesome.
Yes. Yeah, awesome. But your grandmother also.
Yes, my grandmother attended Armstrong. That's right. Mm-hmm. The prices. So when you look at what we're paying today, to attend the movie theater or have a night out on the time, what was your typical budget back then, Ms. Ross?
When we thought about this, and I actually can't remember, because all I can remember, if you had 50 cents, you were set. And I was trying to remember, what did we pay when there were stage shows? I cannot remember. But I know that I could afford to go, afford to buy the snacks and everything.
Excellent.
To just kind of put it in context, now you could ride the streetcar for 10 cents.
Wow.
Then it went up to 25. You buy a pass that for $1.25 that you rode all week. So those kind of prices.
Excellent. So your budget, they weren't too harsh on your budget, but as you said, back then it was still, we just had to really strive extra hard to survive and thrive and have.
Yes, because we have to remember that we didn't have a lot of big jobs, but still that fact that this was factored into our living, our standard of living, our quality of life, was what you had to deal with. There had to be a quality of life. There had to be something that you could just kind of have your diversion, have your entertainment, and being with each other. Because as I said, I did not realize that was called Black Broadway, but we have to realize that this was our main street, even though we had the quadrants. So everybody came up here. This is where you went to be seen, to see, and to do. This is where all the action was. So you were, there was a togetherness.
And so if you lived in Southwest or Southeast or Maryland or Northeast, and you were a person of color, African American, you're, I guess, the center of the hub of entertainment and culture was U Street. That was basically where you could go.
Right off there, up that corridor. Yes.
Excellent, excellent. And so when you talk about, you know, as you said, in addition to these theaters, you know, being a form of entertainment and an opportunity to fellowship, they also provided a lot of jobs and helped to sustain other businesses. You mentioned hanging out at some of the other businesses. Where were some of the other businesses, which oftentimes you could go to, like, say, for example, Cecilia's, which was next door to the Howard Theater. Yes. Did you ever stop in there after one of the shows in the Howard Theater?
Cecilia's, and then she had a sister who had a club up on 12th and U. And this is what I'm saying, you know, when you were mentioning the other avenues that we had, it was a black, you had money turning over in the black community. You had jobs, you had, look, we had a bank, you had your, I guess, fraternal organizations that had buildings that turned over money. I just for an example, okay, we had the Masonic Temple. Mm-hmm. You mostly familiar with the Masonics.
And it's still there.
It's still there. Mm-hmm. But the thing about it, that was also a venue to be able to use for some of our social activities, which in turn they could have money to use for what they supported, you know, their mission. Mm-hmm. So you had that, and then off U Street you had like Odd Fellows Hall, and it was a big time for social activities. Okay, you want a good meal, you go up to Alfred's Steakhouse, and I mean that's just one of the places. And of course, as I said, once I began to go to the, got old enough to go to the clubs, you know, there was no end to the number of clubs. You go even right off U Street, you go to Hollywood, you go to the Offbeat, you Crystal Cavern, who could forget that? Mm-hmm. Republic Gardens. And it was, you know, I did not realize it at the time, but I said the way we presented ourselves then, the way we looked at what we had, I think it sort of determined how we acted. Because that one thing, I don't know, you all are not old enough, but in the black community at one time, you had to be presentable when you went out. We don't have the dress issues like the code, times change.
So the decorum is shifted a little bit.
It has shifted, but if you were going out, first of all, you had to represent your family. You don't go out looking bad, shame your family. Then there was the greater context, your community. Mm-hmm. Then you, it's a phrase when I was real little, you know, that Southern blacks would use it. You got to be a credit to your race.
Yes.
So I think that shaped how we not only felt about where we had our good times, where our businesses were, where we saw our professionals. So when you went into that arena, there was a certain way you felt that you should conduct yourself. And we were not so individualistic then as communal. Mm-hmm. What you did affected those around you.
Excellent, excellent. That's awesome. So I guess it sounds like to me, when you talk about the cultural impact and legacy of the black theaters and that, you know, mm-hmm. along the U Street Quarter, it sort of gave you, molded and shaped your character, your core values, you would say, Ms. Ross?
And we probably did not realize, you know, it was subtly passed down. There were things, it was what you do and you do not do. Yes, it did. And then we were able, you know, when you began this, I said, began to bring up other things that impacted this. And it was how we saw ourselves, because back then we had black newspapers. There were a lot of activities going on. And I can remember the favorable images you had of yourself. When my little sister had her second birthday, you could have your picture put in the paper. So everybody would see that, all, you know, all the community would see that. These were positive images. These were things that connected us.
Excellent.
So it was just more, like I said, it was nothing like, because I'm just looking at the pictures of the theaters and at the colonnade and all of the other activities, civic activities and things that supported church. You know, we had those foundations.
Excellent, Ms. Ross. And so also you mentioned the theaters, they were well maintained and many of the employees looked like us as well, right? Because, you know, it was a big, I guess, employer for the, you know, the East Street Quarter was these theaters as well. Do you recall the way they were dressed? And because I know those were big time jobs back then. You know, if you were a projectionist at the theater or you were a manager or a ticket taker, you know, do you remember just seeing some of their presentation at these theaters?
No, not that I don't recall.
Okay.
Look, at 91, so much of it has gone by.
Well, you're doing great, Ms. Ross.
Into the sea of forgetfulness.
That's okay. But you've taken us back to that wonderful moment in time, and we appreciate it. But we want you to stick around in case someone has any questions after we just sort of do, as I said, a deeper dive into some of the theaters that did exist along the quarter. And I'm just going to share a little bit about the history of some of those places. And feel free to, you know, to jump in if you want to add something while we go to the other PowerPoint and just sort of, you know, again, do a deeper dive into some of the theaters that existed along the U Street Quarter when it was known as Black Broadway to some of us. When did you find out, Ms. Ross, before we go into the PowerPoint presentation, that U Street was called Black Broadway? Because I've heard that from a couple people, actually. And then some say, you know, it was called the Connecticut Avenue for colored people, and then some people.
I've never heard that.
Yeah, so I've heard a variety. When did you discover that it was the street was known?
I'm trying to see if it went before my involvement with you.
Okay. well, that's awesome. All right, is there anything else, Ms. Ross, before we jump into the PowerPoint? And you're going to hang in there with us, right? In case folks have questions at the end. Okay, thank you, Ms. Ross. I appreciate you always. So we'll jump into the PowerPoint presentation. And again, like I said, I am trying to get my controls together. And we're almost there. Okay, here we go. Okay, are we seeing it?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, awesome. So, and again, thank you, everyone. I hope you enjoyed those snapshots. And again, those little anecdotes from Mrs. Ross. I had the great fortune of knowing Ms. Ross for a while. And as she shared, my grandmother and Ms. Ross and some of the other elders have served as my source of inspiration for starting this project. And actually my grandmother, I'll share this little quick story. In 2013, when we were driving down U Street, 14th Street actually, and she was just shocked because the community was changing so much.
Yes.
And in that moment in time, she started to share her memories and her firsthand stories like Ms. Ross just did. And I just didn't know all of this culture and all this history that took place along the U Street Quarter. So it inspired me to launch this project, which hopefully will, you know, enlighten not only this generation and generations to come so that we can understand, you know, where we came from and whose shoulders we stand on right here in our own backyard. All righty. So back to the thrust of our discussion today. The cultural impact and legacy of Black theaters on DC's Black Broadway. And so for the first half of the 20th century, local theaters had a profound cultural and social economic influence on the Black community living in the historic U Street Quarter, later known as Black Broadway. And if you're not familiar with who dubbed U Street as Black Broadway, it's been credited to the late, great singer, actress, comedian, Pearl Bailey, who actually jump-started her career along the U Street Quarter. Mm-hmm. And many folks said she jump-started her career when she was a teenager at the Republic Gardens. And for those of you that grew up and lived in the quarter, she actually attended Garnett Patterson Junior High School as well, which it's was right there on Vermont and 10th and U, that little interesting intersection there. So while the founding of Black theaters along the U Street Black Broadway quarter saw its heyday in the early 20th century, sadly, only two of these theaters remain open today, the Lincoln Theater and the Howard Theater. And if you didn't know, the Howard Theater was the first theater in Washington, DC to exclusively serve Blacks. Black Washingtonians, and Ms. Ross sort of shared that, were forbidden to attend white theaters or even stand in the balconies at, you know, some of the theaters that were downtown or other in other communities outside of the U Street quarter. And they were oftentimes excluded as performers until integration in the mid 1950s. So, you know, Jim Crow was in full effect in DC. You know, many times we forget that we're below the Mason-Dixon line. So we're, you know, in many ways, we're still a sleepy Southern town, but we're on the uptick. That's changing rapidly as well. So from the late 1920s and 40s, Abe Lichtman was a Jewish theater circuit owner who specialized in Black theaters and owned and operated the Howard, the Lincoln, and the Booker T Theater. And we're going to talk about the Booker T Theater in a few moments. And then I'll share where that was located. And he had a significant involvement in Black Broadway through theater ownership and hired a majority Black staff, as we just talked about. Some numbers I've seen and read in my research, at one point in time, he had upwards of 300 employees who, you know, fill those upper management jobs, which were coveted jobs if you got an opportunity to manage some of those theaters. And he also had other venues that he owned and operated beyond theaters, and not just theaters along the U Street quarter as well. And again, he seems to have been well-loved in the Black community. The Lincoln and the Howard Theaters, he turned over ownership so he owned it for the 1920s and 40s. And so the Lincoln and Howard Theaters were the twin flagships of the Freedman family's district theaters, which owned them between about 1946 and 1965. And as Ms. Ross shared, they were first run movie houses playing the current films from Hollywood. So when these theaters specifically, the Lincoln Theater, and I'll talk about that later, but when they added sound to films, that was a large deal, you know, and that started to take place towards the late 1920s. And so that really elevated, you know, the importance of theaters and the opportunity to see Hollywood films as they came out. This was a large deal, you know, for the African American community, and, definitely a point of social and cultural exchange for us along the U Street quarter. So now one of the first theaters we're going to talk about is the Minnehaha Theater. Some of you may know the backstory of this theater, and it was located at 1213 U Street Northwest in Washington, of course, and the seating capacity was 200 seats. And it was officially called the Minnehaha Nickelodeon Theater. It was erected in 1909, and it opened in 1910 and operated, as I said, as a 200-seat silent movie theater, because we're talking 1910. So this is before what they called talkies. You know, everything was silent. You remember Charlie Chaplin, and you had the Vaudeville Theater, and it was managed by Sherman H. Dudley, who was a prominent vaudeville performer and entrepreneur and just overall theater magnet. We're going to talk about him as we visit some of the other theaters that existed along the U Street quarter. And so he purchased the Minnehaha and owned and operated it from 1913 until 1920. And he renamed it Dudley Theater after, of course, himself. And he was a pioneer in the world of entertainment, working his way up from medicine shows and traveling minstrel shows. He had great success on the stage as an entrepreneur, although he was more than a competent singer, writer, actor, and composer. And his company was named after one of his vaudeville shows, which was one of his heralded performances. It was called Smart Set, which he actually performed at the Howard Theater as well. And so Dudley was pretty well known, not just along U Street, just all over the country, because he was taking, you know, African-American or Black performers, or back then Negro performers down south, and with this company. And so he was building, you know, a base through the vaudeville circuit as well. And as I shared, when vaudeville X and salad films slowly started fading away in the 1920s, due to the introduction of the popular talkies, which is films with sound, the theater became a pool hall by the 1920s. And that's the Minnehaha Theater became a pool hall. And Dudley was the first to establish the, as I said, the Black vaudeville theater circuit. And it was known, it was called the S.H. Dudley Theatrical Enterprises, which was the name he had given the company, and the base of it, which were several theaters that he owned and managed in and around Washington, D.C. And again, as we go down and visit some of these other theaters, I'll reveal some of the other U Street theaters that Sherman H. Dudley was an investor in or either managed. So he was very successful. As I said, he was a theater magnate. And today, the Minnehaha Theater is the home of the world famous Ben's Chili Bowl, which, as we know, is still there. It's I don't know if any of you feel the same way. Every time I go to Ben's, you know, especially the one on U Street, I feel like I'm stepping back into that moment of time of, you know, when it was Black Broadway. Although by 1958, you know, the Black Broadway quarter was starting to change, you know, because the heyday was, yes, you know, the 30s and 40s and, you know, the early 50s. But if you ever down there, just look up if you haven't done so already, and you'll still see the facade of the Minnehaha theaters. And, if, you know, it still remains visible. And it's a continuing reminder of the building's status as the last former Nickelodeon theater in D.C. So next up, we're going to head over to 7th Street. And I think you mentioned hanging out on 7th Street, you know, which is, you know, the Howard Theater is right off of 7th Street. Mm-hmm. And there was another theater on 7th Street that was pretty popular that was steps from the Howard Theater as well. But before we get to those theaters, we're going to talk about the Broadway Theater, which was located at 1515 7th Street. And that's the block of 7th Street. If you're familiar with the U Street Quarter, if you're heading from down 7th Street and you're driving away from U Street, Florida Avenue, going towards Rhode Island Avenue, it was on your left-hand side. Do you remember the Broadway Theater, Mrs. Ross?
Yes, because that was, you know, I went to Shaw Junior High, so that was right down the street. All this was, you may as well say, my walking neighborhood.
And what did you remember? Because it is not a lot of information out there on the Broadway Theater, but I, you know, what I found out, of course, it was patronized by, you know, the, as you said, it was in your neighborhood and we lived in that neighborhood. However, it opened in December 19th, 1921. Mm-hmm. And that's fun. I didn't know you went to Shaw Junior High School. My grandmother and grandfather went to Shaw Junior High School. I guess, you know, that's another discussion, but there were certain high schools and junior high schools that we could attend during that era as well, because of good old Jim Crow and segregation. Mm-hmm. So I'm sure you, you know, everyone went to those same schools, you know. So in 1927, the patronage was $4,500 per week, and it was described as a handsome two-story brick and terracotta building. It was demolished in the 1980s. Okay. So Can you help us fill in the gap about what the Black, the Broadway theater was like on 7th Street, Ms. Ross? And is that that quarter as well, that block? Because 7th Street was a popular hub as well.
Okay, now, for some reason, a lot of the smaller theaters, like you've got the Broadway here, I really didn't go that much. It was the bigger theaters.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know whether just felt might have felt safer, but it was Lincoln, Republic, Booker T, and of course Howard that I frequented more.
Okay, and they were just more grand, right?
Huh?
They just had that grandness.
Yeah, that was the ones I went to mostly. It did not, and since I didn't like Westerns, I didn't go to Dunbar.
So. Okay. and like you said, Broadway was a little smaller. The seating capacity was 500. So it wasn't, you know, of course, you know, I don't want to get too deep into Howard and Lincoln, not yet. But so I'm starting with the smaller theaters and working our way up to the bigger theaters. So next up is the Booker T Theater, which was at 1433 U Street.
Yes.
And the seating capacity was small as well.
Yeah,
497 around, you know, 500 seats, and it opened in 1913 as the Olympic Theater for the Columbia Amusement Company. And 1921, there's Mr. Dudley again. It was renamed Dudley Theater and run by vaudeville performer, theater magnate, and entrepreneur Sherman H. Dudley, who, by the way, was from Texas, and I believe he was born around 1872. And he passed away by 1940, but he had done pretty well for himself. And then in April 1928, it was renamed, the Booker T Theater was renamed the Bandbox Theater. And then a year later in April 1929, it was taken over by Abe Lichtman and Lichtman Theaters and renamed Booker T Theater. And once again, it catered to the African American community that lived, you know, along U Street, 7th Street. You know, you had the Strivers District, which was that right down the street. And so, you know, they had a pretty good audience, you know, or community that could sustain, you know, all of these theaters. Because as you said, even if you didn't live in the neighborhood, you had to come to the U Street quarter to see a movie because the other theaters were segregated.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is just a tidbit beyond the, because this is sort of my era, I don't want to date myself, but I remember going to the Booker T theaters in, you know, the late 60s and early 70s, and it was a whole different situation, sadly.
Yeah.
You know, going, even the Republic Theater back then as well, it wasn't what you experienced, but it was only, it was one of only two theaters in the DC area brave enough to show the infamous 1970s film, Nigger Lover, AKA The Bad Bunch. The other theater being the Lowe's Palace Theater, which was down on F Street. I remember going to the Lowe's Palace quite often, especially to see groups back in the 70s. And unfortunately, the Booker T Theater was closed in late 1976 and became a church for several years. And currently, if you're on U Street, after you pass the Reeves Center, you'll see the Portner Place Apartments. And now they've built another apartment building, I think, before the original Portner Place Apartments, which I believe is also an extension of the Portner Place original apartments. But that's where the Booker T Theater was. And talking about those streets for a second, Ms. Ross, I share with a lot of folks, when you walked on U Street as well, there were row houses, right? Up and down the streets. So how does that feel when you go down there? You know, just a change in the landscape, you know, and the buildings and everything. Cause it had more of a neighborhood vibe back then as well, right?
Yes, it did, yes. And now I don't even know where I am when I go in there.
I understand.
And when you were speaking about going to the Booker T, by being on U Street, you know, that still had a little clout. I remember in the 40s taking my Cabin in the Sky played. I remember taking my little sister and how thrilled, she's older than you and she still talks about that.
Wow. And Cabin and Sky was Lena Horne in
Lena
that?
Lena Horne, Ethel Waters, Rochester Anderson.
And did you ever have a chance to see them perform in person? So how was that? You know, you saw them on the big screen or some of these screens at the Lincoln or Howard or Republic or Booker T. And then did you ever have an opportunity to see Lena Horne or Ethel Waters perform at Howard or Lincoln or?
I'm trying to remember. I thought I saw Ethel Waters.
Okay.
And, you know, for a brief time when I, in 1940, it was kind of hard getting places to stay, so we moved quite a bit. And one address that I lived on was right around the corner from Howard. And that's where you would see the stars coming from, taking their little breaks. And there was a nightclub right across from where I lived. And you would see them out there.
Wow.
See them coming, you know, between breaks, see them coming, maybe come around to the club, just to relax and whatnot. But no, but I can't recall seeing Lena Horne in person, but I believe I saw Ethel Waters.
Okay, awesome.
In person, yeah.
And that's another thing that was so special about having these big venues and theaters and the community, because like you said, you could be sitting in your house. I've heard several elders that lived in the community back then tell me, you know, they might have been a shoe shiner or something, and they got called over to the Howard Theater to take care of Duke Ellington or Cab Calloway or Billy Eckstein, you know, in between performances. And so that was, you know, that's a rarity that doesn't happen these days either. You can't get next to these stars. So I know that was magical as well.
It was. It was. As I remember when Louis Jordan was playing around at Howard. And of course, another one of the businesses that we had in the community, right in that block, there was a record store. And he happened to be in the record store. So, of course, I had to get an autographed picture, which I treasured for years. Oh, but it was awesome. That kind of proximity to these, you know, with the people, they were right there.
And they were approachable as well, right?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Sadly, we don't have that type of fellowship or connection anymore. But that's, again, that's what made it. The culture, you know, just very vibrant. And again, that's a very special legacy about the impact of the community and these theaters and what it meant to, you know, folks in the community who may not get out of the community, but to have an opportunity to interface with some of these great artists and musicians. I know that was just priceless.
It was.
So we're going to travel back to 7th Street. Back to the Dunbar Theater, and you mentioned the Dunbar Theater a few times, which was located, it's still there, fortunately, the building's still there. It's not the Dunbar Theater, but the good thing is you can still see the Dunbar sign, and sometimes it's still even lit up, but it's located at, you know, that whole little corner there, which is 1901 to 1903 7th Street Northwest, and it was small too. The seating capacity was 346 seats. So you went there, Ms. Ross, even though it was too small.
No, because it was I wasn't interested in Westerns.
Oh, that's right.
That was not my forte. So I never went in. In fact, when we were living across, that's where I was living near, right across from the Dunbar for a brief time. No, I didn't even go across the street to them. I didn't like those movies.
Yeah, no, I understand.
It was popular. You better believe it was popular.
No, I'm sure it was. So so we'll just, again, just share a little snapshot about the Dunbar Theater and hop over there real quick. It was located steps away from the larger and equally historic Howard Theater. It opened in October 18th, 1920. It was designed by Black architect Isaiah T. Hatton in the earlier Southern Aid Society building, sharing the same floor as a retail space. The floors above the theater contain the headquarters of the Southern Aid Society, which, you know, if you're not familiar, and they were one of the oldest African American life insurance companies in the nation. And the building also housed office space, and residence for African American tenants. And even today, I believe there's still some residences in the Dunbar building over top of the bank that's there now. And as I said, the nearly 350 seat Dunbar was a popular venue for live entertainment, of course, including many legendary jazz and blues artists such as Duke Ellington. And so it's interesting, you know, even though Duke Ellington had, you know, moved to New York in the early 1920s, he often came back to Washington, his hometown, to perform. And I'm sure even, you know, when you juxtapose, and that's why I'm so fascinated, and I feel like this history that existed, this Black history along the U Street Quarter, again, when you juxtapose it to what was happening in other major cities, specifically Harlem, you know, where Duke Ellington landed, they didn't have all, you know, all of these Black theaters, many of which were Black owned, a few of them at various points in times, and they were segregated. They couldn't, you know, go to the Cotton Club or some of the other venues where to see a Duke Ellington because it was a segregated space. And so, I see, even though we were a Southern sleeping town here in DC, there was still a level of progressiveness taking place and innovation and forward thinking, you know, to have these spaces where we could go, even though the city was segregated at large, we still had a community. And hence, that's a very significant, you know, not just cultural impact, but again, a major socioeconomic impact. Yes. And as we, you know, using the language of today, we had our own ecosystem, you know, which was just phenomenal. And so you mentioned, you know, that it was known for its Westerns. And so they show movies, Duke Ellington. So you didn't catch any of the performers, because I know there were a lot of other performers that, because again, 7th Street right there, they had quite a few clubs right there.
Yes.
That existed right there on that corner. Keys Restaurant was right there, and just a lot of just major places were right there on that corner of 7th and T, right down from the Howard Theater.
Yes.
But I wanted to mention that, again, this was, as we talk about the community and the cultural impact and the legacy of these spaces, that the Dunbar Theater was actually, as we said, built by a Black architect, but it was also financed and owned by a prominent African-American Black family that had a variety of businesses along the U Street Quarter and 7th Street, which was the Murray family. And I don't know if you all have heard of the Murray Brothers Printing Company, which was on U Street. They also owned Murray Casinos, which was a popular venue where Duke Ellington and, you know, all of the greats in the 20s and 30s and 40s performed. You know, again, it was a social space, as you mentioned, Ms. Ross, where you went to other social functions and activities beyond just seeing the artists or, you know, perform the popular artists. It was also an opportunity to fraternize and fellowship with the folks in the community as well. And I found out that one of the investors of this, they had formed a company, it was called United Theater Corporation. But it was also owned by a piece of it. Sherman H. Dudley also owned a piece of it, and the Murray family. And it was managed by Raymond H. Murray and Marshall Murray. It was the first neighborhood theater that was not owned by a white owner, which I think is very significant. And you're talking about a space that opened in October 18th, 1920. So, you know, that's you know, a major cultural impact and a lot of just progressive things happening. As I mentioned, we were dealing with the prejudice and discrimination, you know, were intensifying due to Jim Crow. It was an oasis, you know, a refuge amid a lot of growing tension, you know, that was taking place. Because, you know, when you look at the 20s and the 30s, what also had a very significant impact on U Street in particular, and we'll talk about that later, was the Great Depression and the war, World War II,
yes,
as well. And so, again, these theaters provided just a safe haven from us you know, so that we could step inside of these places and transcend, and, you know, just sort of transcend from a moment for everything else that was happening outside of the theater, you know, during the Great Depression and World War II. And it was opened, as I mentioned, in 1920, and sadly it closed in 1960. And it's my understanding by that time, the theater had fallen on hard times, sadly, because, you know, of good old integration, you know? And so once, you know, the city opened up and the theaters, we could go to theaters downtown, we sort of abandoned some of these theaters. And so unfortunately by 1960, it had shuttered, but it had a good run for 40 years. Yes. And it was added to the National Register of Historic Places in 1986. And the building remained idle for many years and unused until now. Some of you, if you live over along the U Street corridor, you might have an account there at Wells Fargo Bank. But, and again, it's my understanding that there are some residents upstairs as well. Okay, moving along to the next theater is the Republic Theater. We're back on U Street now. It was at 1333 U Street. And I don't know, there's still a little piece of it if you're walking on U Street after you pass the Ellington apartment building, and there's a little alley there. If you look up on the edge of that building, there's a little piece of the Republic Theater right there. So if you look at the picture, if you come on down U Street, and there's a little alley there, you can't see it really in this picture, but it's before you hit 14th, there's a little alley there. What is it, the wine places there, 1301 Ben and some other places. But right after you pass the Ellington, you hit that alley, look up at that building straight ahead, and there's a little piece of the Republic Theater there. So the seating capacity was 1,250 seats. So that's when you're talking some of the bigger and, you know, more grandiose venues and spaces. Mm-hmm. And this year would have been the 100th anniversary of the Republic Theater. It opened in May 30th, 1921. And it was centrally located in the heart of the U Street business district there. Because, you know, when we talk about U Street, Black Broadway, many people, they're looking at where it begins at the intersection right there where Florida changes to U Street all the way down to 18th Street. So if you, again, if you're in the 30s and 40s and 50s on U Street, there's houses on both sides of the street, except for the blocks where you had businesses. Is that correct, Ms. Ross? Yes. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so was there anything you remembered? And sadly, the Republic closed 1976 as well, and it was demolished to make room for the Metro, which really hurt the community. That's a whole nother conversation when they started building the subway on U Street, which of course took longer than anticipated. But I remember those wooden planks on U Street back then, and just some of the issues, and it just really, what, you know, impacted the businesses that remain, and specifically, you know, places like Howard Theater and Lincoln Theater, for example, because you couldn't get to those places during the early 80s when they were building the subway on U Street and other parts of the city. All righty, so moving along, because I know we're getting to our Q&A time. We're still on U Street. Now we're at the Lincoln Theater at 1215 U Street, next to Ben's Chili Bowl. And again, as we talk about the cultural impact, we cannot talk about the socioeconomic impact of these spaces. Because again, when it was open, a lot of folks would leave Lincoln Theater, and when Ben's opened, they would hop on over to Ben's Chili Bowl or some of the other clubs, Casbah, and, you know, the many other clubs that were on. You forgot the Casbah.
Sure.
And some of the, that's why you got to get on the Black Broadway on you.com website, Ms. Ross, and anyone else on the call, so you can check out and learn more about some of the other venues that we've been talking about and spaces that were on U Street and along 7th Street as well. All righty, so we're at the Lincoln Theater, which, you know, was one of the most iconic of Black Broadway's many theaters. The Lincoln Theater opened to the public in August 1922, and it was billed as the crown jewel on you. Now, if that doesn't sound luxurious and grand, I don't know what to say. And again, the Lincoln is a relic of the days of segregation when the theater was used exclusively by Black audiences and managed by Blacks. And again, those were very coveted jobs to run the theaters or work in the theaters. And they really employed a lot of people in that community. As I shared earlier, some of the data that I've seen at one moment in time, Abe Lichtman, and then the, you know, later it was taken over. He sold the theaters to the District Theater Corporation, but, you know, they really employed and helped to elevate, you know, the social economic status of many Blacks who lived in that community at that time. And so when it opened in 1922, it didn't have sound. The movies didn't have, it was a silent movie house. And again, it was the center of an African-American cultural revival, renaissance, or however you want to describe it, that predated the Harlem Renaissance. And many folks, you know, if you get a chance to take a deep dive into this history, I really feel like it was, you know, to me, we were making just some really progressive moves. I don't like to compare, but we rivaled, you know, as I said, the Harlem Renaissance. And it was doubling as a silent movie house and a music venue. And in 1928, it was wired for sound. And then they installed that ballroom and that tunnel, Ms. Ross, to the Lincoln Colonnade. And of course, in the theater's heyday, it featured legendary talents. Of course, our good old native Washingtonian Duke Ellington, Fats Waller, Jelly Roll Morton, who also managed another venue, which is now Ben's Next Door. It went through a variety of names. It was the Jungle Inn, it was the Jewel Box, and he was there about a year or so before he passed away in the 1930s. He managed that venue there, which is now Ben's Next Door. But when he was there, it was called, as I said, it was the Jewel Box, and then it was the Jungle Inn. But as my understanding, it was a rough spot. But I think that was before your time, Ms. Ross, of hanging out on U Street. And so again, Nat King Cole, Lionel Hampton, Ella Fitzgerald, Cab Calloway, Billie Holiday, and Sarah Vaughan. That's just a short list of some of the, as you mentioned, there are a lot of other artists. You know, of course, we always hone into the big names, but there were other major artists like Louis Jordan, one of my favorite artists, that Lester Young, who performed with Billie Holiday. I love Lester Young, and then other folks too, John Malachi. Just a lot of great artists are coming through there. And behind the theater was the Lincoln Colonnade, a dance hall with that wonderful tunnel entrance. And again, if you're coming down the alley between the Lincoln Theater and Ben's Chili Bowl, there's still a sign up there. It's a side door over there. And I believe part of the tunnel may still be there. There's a door on the side there. And I believe it says the tunnel. There's some sort of, I haven't been on U Street that much with COVID, but I have some video I took about 2 years ago, because I was shocked when I was coming down the alley and noticed that there was a sign there still for that tunnel. When you used to go down that tunnel, and it's my understanding it was a long walk to get down there.
It was
down in there, Miss Ross.
It was a long walk, but it was the anticipation of the fun you were going to have when you hit that ballroom.
And it was magical, that walk.
Yes, yes, it was.
It was like the yellow brick road, huh? Going to Oz, you know, the yellow brick road.
Yellow brick road.
Also. And so, as we said, again, all of these greats were performing there. President Roosevelt had birthday parties. Mm-hmm. There were other major inaugural balls and just a variety. Social clubs had events in the Lincoln Colonnade. And some of the images I showed earlier, you saw some of the social clubs like Bachelor of Benedict.
Yes.
And some of the sororities and fraternities. Some were Greek, some were non-Greek. Some of the pictures we showed earlier, There were some of the events that some of the Black fraternities from Howard, you know, because, you know, again, Howard University anchored this community as well. And so, like many folks, when they go to college, they typically stay in that community. And so, you know, from, again, going back to the data from what I read in some places during my research, it was my understanding that in the 1940s, U Street had the most African American college graduates in the country lived along the U Street corridor as well. So, because it was the place to be, you know, and, you know, we talked about, you know, the businesses, but many of them, you know, who attended Howard and studied law or medicine or, you know, whatever field they studied, oftentimes couldn't get a job. So they became entrepreneurs and opened up their businesses on U Street, which again was part of this ecosystem.
Yes.
So so again, public figures like Ralph Bunche, Sterling Brown, another native Washingtonian, and Joe Lewis, who was, my understanding, frequented U Street often, as well as Jackie Robinson. You could run into them a lot hanging out on U Street. So how am I doing on time, Melissa? So we talked about the, we're okay? And so,
yes, yeah, we're okay.
Okay, and so the Lincoln Theater eventually was converted to a movie theater, as we talked about, because again, when that integration hit, sadly, you know, in the 1950s, yes, people were able to move around the city a bit more. We, you know how they say that grass is greener on the other side. We had to find out, and so we abandoned, you know, our theaters, and then folks didn't have to travel so much from Maryland or different parts of the city, because now they could go out in their own neighborhood, you know, in the late 1950s as well. And if you were in Maryland back then, that was like traveling to Baltimore, if you lived in Hyattsville, you know, or just across, you know, the bridge or whatever, Woodrow Wilson Bridge. It felt like you were going on a long trip, I'm sure. And so, again, it remained as a converted movie theater until 1903 when it closed, 1983 rather. And in 1984, it was purchased by the city and once again converted into a venue for legitimate theater and music now, and reopened on February 4th, 1994. That was a big deal. I remember when the Lincoln Theater reopened, it was a who's who in the community entertainment. You know, it represented, it was a very diverse event. That was a major deal when it opened back up in 1994, and it's still there. All right, now we're at our final destination, which is the Howard Theater, 620 T Street Northeast, and the capacity was 1,242 seats. And just making sure everyone, we're honing in on the theaters. That's the thrust of our discussion today. And so the Howard Theater, although it opened in June of 1910, the grand opening was August 22nd, 1910. And it was billed as a theater of the people. And it accommodated around 1,200 people. It was designed by an architect, J. Edward Stork, and built for the National Amusement Company. During the mid-1920s, it was sold to Abe Lichtman. And in its early years, the Howard featured not only vaudeville, but live theater, musicals, and local talent shows. The theater was also home to two theatrical companies, the Lafayette Players and the Howard University Players, who were also known as the Howard Players under the direction of Alain Locke, who is known as the father of the Negro Renaissance. And he was a professor at Howard University as well. So, and folks like Zora Neale Hurston performed with the Lafayette Players and the Howard Players. So, you know, just a lot of great people were coming again, a lot of leading literary artists, entertainers, performers, you know, and a lot of folks like Pearl Bailey. That's how they got their acting chops, you know, by performing in these plays, because they were extravagant. I mean, they weren't like you know, they were, it would be 75 people or hundreds of people performing in these plays, and they were very serious, because many of these plays, they also use as a form of expression to talk about, again, some of the things that were happening in, you know, in the Black community, you know, racism, you know, basically, you know, some of the issues of the day. They use these plays as a form of protest and expression, you know, to address what was happening in the community. In 1929, during the Great Depression, it became a church for a couple of years. And the church that had their services in Howard Theater, it's on George Avenue now, it's still there, was Elder Solomon Michaud. He was very, some folks saw him as controversial, but he did a lot for the community back then. They fed a lot of people, because again, we're talking the Great Depression. So a lot of folks had fallen on hard times. And sadly, you know, when these pandemic hits, you know, typically, you know, that the reality is, you know, the African-American community is oftentimes hit just a tad bit harder. But the good news is in 1931, Shep Allen, and I have a funny story about that if we have time, a theater manager from Atlantic City, but Shep Allen was actually from Chicago. So he came to us via Atlantic City. It reopened in September 1931 as a movie house and live entertainment venue. And you know, we had to bring the one and only Duke Ellington to ignite the reopening in September 1931. And it's my understanding Duke was tickling the ivory keys on the Howard's grand piano. And it was a fabulous event, you know, because the Howard Theater was also where, you know, the Black elite, you had a lot of the political leaders and ministers and just major community leaders attended the Howard Theater. But the really cool thing was that it was an integrated theater. Again, so when you juxtapose what was happening along the U Street corridor, as far as, you know, an integrated social event and people are fellowshipping in this community, that was very rare when you're looking at that time frame in our country and that history. So, and then when Shep Allen came, again, we were progressive, you know, everyone knows about amateur night at the Apollo Theater, but they don't always remember that Shep Allen launched that before they were doing the amateur night, and that Ella Fitzgerald actually won at the Howard Theater amateur night. And so again, if you go to the Black Broadway on You website, you can see a picture of young Ella Fitzgerald performing at the Howard Theater in 1935. So, and then Billy Eckstein, your guy won amateur night, and then Bill Kenny, who was famous, a singer with the, you remember the Ink Spots, because we always tend to focus on the jazz, but there were a lot of doo-wop groups, and many of whom got their start and lived along the U Street corridor, and they were performing at the Howard Theater as well. And of course, Pearl Bailey was actually, she made appearances as a singer, but she always also was a part of the Howardettes, which was a chorus line that they had performing at. Do you remember the Howardettes, Ms. Ross?
I had a friend who I think was a part of that.
Was a member of the Howardettes?
She was, yeah, she was in the chorus line.
Awesome.
Oh, okay. No, she was a little bit older than I was. I didn't have that kind of freedom.
But I'm sure that was a large deal as well.
It was.
And this is just an ad from the Washington Star to announce the opening of the theater in 1910, August 22nd. And again, it was the grand opening, but the theater actually opened in June of 1910. And a year later, it was managed, you know, had the first, its first African-American or Black manager, Andrew J. Thomas took over as a manager like a year later. But again, they were bringing all types of artists in there. So we mentioned International Sweethearts, you know, these all same, Dinah Washington, Lena Horne, Sammy Davis. And then again, you know, I'm a jazz person, so I tend to focus on that. But let's not discount the rhythm and blues, rock, and the doo-wop groups. You know, you had James Brown and, you know, Marvin Gaye, who was another native Washington as well. Mm-hmm. You know, they were all performing in there. And again, you know, by the late 1950s, the clientele changed. And so, you know, the yes. Howard Theater fell on hard times. And actually, because it has fallen on hard times quite often through the years, it has an undercover nickname known as the White Elephant, you know, because it's just hard to keep it going. But I'm happy, and I'm sure everyone is aware now that it's back open now. And, you know, it was decaying, and it had several revivals. I remember even in the early 70s when it opened. It opened up in like 1975. And I wish I could show you. I have this brochure, this booklet that they put together. It's phenomenal. It has ads and everything from that era. And so that's it. And I hope you all enjoyed that, those little anecdotes and those stories about what was happening on U Street and the theaters and the cultural impact and the legacy of these theaters that to remain, and the other ones that existed, you know, that opened in the early part of the 21st century or the 20th century. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you both. That was absolutely wonderful. And yes, we have a couple of questions.
Okay. And sorry, it was a lot of ground. I didn't even get heavy into it.
Well, that is incentive for folks to go to the Black Broadway on You website and learn more.
Oh, sorry, yes. I concur. Thank you for that, Melissa. Thank
you're
you.
You're welcome.
I'm a little winded.
I will put the URL into the chat again if folks want to go visit blackbroadwayonyou.com.
Yes, and please follow us on social media. I'm going to try to do a better job. I was posting a lot, but you know, we're multitasking. Just go back through some of the other posts. There's a lot of history there. So outside of the website as well.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. Please go give them a follow. Yes.
Please.
So we have a question from Lawrence. Now, we talked about segregation and, you know, the transition from a segregated Washington to a Washington that's beginning to integrate, right? So I guess Lawrence wanted to know, did white Washingtonians, were they ever on U Street attend, like going to these theaters, I guess, before or even after the city started to integrate?
Yeah, remember I mentioned the Howard Theater when it opened, it was integrated in 1910. That's major. That's a large deal for 1910, you know? And again, DC was very much a sleepy Southern town. So, Ms. Ross, did you want to add anything about that?
No, because that was the actual situation. I guess we had a form of desegregation because of the attractiveness of what we had to offer. And if the whites decide they want to come, they come to the clubs, they come to the theaters. So that's the way it was.
And then he had another question about where did the stars stay while they were here to perform?
You want me to answer that, Ms. Ross?
Okay.
It's up to you. Because there weren't a lot of hotels.
No.
So there were, boarding houses. Yes.
Yes.
And then Cecilia's was another popular place, which was a club next to the Howard Theater. They had some hotel rooms, but people rented their rooms out, you know? Yes. And then of course you had the Whitelaw Hotel and the 12th Street Y was another place where they stayed, and the Whitelaw Hotel on 13th Street as well. And then in people's homes.
And then Anne asks, was Republic Gardens associated with the Republic Theater at all? No.
I mean, it was there, but it was another venue. Did you want to say anything about, and Republic Gardens was huge back there as well.
Yes.
And they actually had a garden in the back of it. Is that right, Miss Ross?
I told you we had it all.
Yeah. I remember because my mom said ballet was huge in the Black community, taking ballet. Mm-hmm. And they used to have recitals in the garden at Republic Gardens.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. wonderful. That sounds lovely.
Yeah.
And then Marie asked, it seems the Lincoln is underused there these days. Plans to promote more programs? Has the community talked about what they would like to kind of utilize the theater for? Like kind of what's going on there?
Well, I mean, to me, it's a reflection of the changing demographics in right. the community. You know, it's not what it was, you know, when it was Black Broadway. So, you know, I would like to see them open it up and have more diverse acts in the Lincoln Theater. Because I would be at the Lincoln Theater, even in the early 2000s, to the mid 2000s, mm-hmm. maybe once a week, I'm from DC. So, and my cousin was actually the general manager of the Lincoln Theater, so I was in there all the time.
Yes, you had the VIP, right? Maybe, I don't know.
Yes, I did. But yeah, I would like to see, you know, hopefully, after COVID, you know, them just mix it up a little bit more with the diversity, because it's definitely not like it was, as I said, even in, you know, the mid-2000s even, you know.
Right, yeah. So she also asked, when Mr. Lickman left the theater business, how were the theaters transferred to other owners? What became of his theater ventures in DC and elsewhere?
Yeah, I don't know if I mentioned that around 1946, I know the District Theater Corporation, which was ran by the Freeman family, they purchased and they ran the Howard Theater and the Lincoln Theater. And they were the ones that, ran it until they shuttered, you know, basically. Yeah. I think they might have sold it in the late or early 60s, I believe, the Freeman family. So I think, and I mentioned that in the presentation. So I think they own specifically the Lincoln and the Howard Theater from like 1946 to maybe 1965 or something like that. Mm-hmm. The District Theater Corporation. Some folks just call it District Theaters.
Mm, okay. And then I guess one final question, well, not question, but with comment from Hask, and sorry if I'm mispronouncing your name. They said, thank you so much, wonderful presentation. I remember going to all the theaters you mentioned and my ticket prices at the time was around 25 cents.
Mm-hmm. So, okay. Some of the ads say that, 25 cents.
25 cents.
That sounds
and again, you could go to an 11 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 7 o'clock, 9 o'clock. And then they had the music at night, you know, because they had live radio shows at the Howard Theater as well with William Conover. You remember Bill Conover?
Yes.
Jazz in America?
Yeah.
It was live, broadcast live in the 50s. There's some out there, some great show with Miles Davis and some other greats from the in February 1953, I think, is incredible.
Well, I guess this is kind of where we have to end it today.
Okay,
there's some there were some questions that we didn't have time to answer right now, but I'll just collect those, and if it's okay with you, Shellée, I might pass them along and maybe reach out to those folks with the answers.
Absolutely.
So I just want to thank you both again so much for the wonderful presentation. And thank you again, Ms. Ross, for-
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you so much for joining us today and kind of taking us back and telling us about all your wonderful memories of attending these places. It was really great to hear from you both.
Yeah. And thank you for joining me, Ms. Ross, because it's all about the firsthand memories. You remember, you know what it was like.
Yes.
I'm just the storyteller. The reporter.
But catch them before all of the memories are gone at this stage.
Yes.
No, you're absolutely right. Yeah. So yeah, with that, I just want to say before we, officially close out here, I just want to let everybody know, what we have planned for the remainder of July as part of our 50th anniversary celebration. So this month, as you know, historic theaters, and next week on Wednesday, we are having an in-person tour of the Avalon Theater in Chevy Chase, the known as the oldest operating movie house in the DC metro area. Okay. Yeah, and next month we're heading east of the river as we continue our celebration. So stay tuned to see what exciting events that we have planned for August. And with that, I just want to wish everybody a nice rest of your day. Thank you again, Shellée and Ms. Ross, for taking the time to share this wonderful history with us.
And thank you again, Melissa, to you, Rebecca.
Thank you for asking.
Yes, and your sponsors for giving us an opportunity to just have at it. Because this is our passion, talking about this history, because it's little known, I feel.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So again, I just want to encourage everybody to visit the Black Broadway on your website, follow them on social media, and stay up to date on what they're working on and learn more, not just about theaters, but other venues that were on.
Yes, we're doing theaters today.
Yeah, theaters today, but there's so much more on the project's website. So please take a look at that.
Yes.
And with that, have a wonderful rest of your day.
All right. Thank you so much.
To all of you.
Stay safe and be well, everyone. Thank you, Melissa.
Yeah, okay. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Right. Bye.
Thanks, Ms. Ross.
You're quite welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Ross.